when your soul been occupied by something greater than you, something really powerful, you don't feel yourself. And that's why the awliya and the salihin, they go in the dhikr of Allah until they reach a point they don't feel themselves. They get into status, and thus they call it the mi'raj. But the mi'raj, not a physical, like Rasulullah SAW, when did Isra' al-Mi'raj, they did the mi'raj with their soul, that the soul doesn't feel the world anymore. And that's a beautiful dhikr. And then, at that moment, you ask Allah by His names. Ya Rahman, Ya Allah, Ya Rahim, and so on. Ya Hayy, Ya Allah, Ya Qayyum, Ya Ghaffar, Ya Sattar, so on. And then, toward the end, what you do, you feel yourself, who am I to be at the level like this, and I'm not doing the right respect that should be done? And that's what we say, Astaghfirullah, we do Istaghfar. The same way, by the way, Rasulullah ﷺ taught us, when you go to pray, you say, Allahu Akbar, he said, Allah will be, the moment you say Allahu Akbar, Allah in front of you. And if you're focusing in your prayer, Allah will stay with you. The moment you think of dunya or anything of not from prayer, first time Allah will give it to you, that's fine. Second time Allah will leave you. So some people, when you do this, they are in the presence with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the hadra with Allah. That's why when we say al-Fatiha, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد إياك I'm talking to somebody in front of me إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين this call is the hadra with Allah so and then goes on that's why when the tashahud when we finish the prayer what do we say التحيات لله يا الله I'm greeting you صلوات الطيبات And then I move to, as I see Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, talk to him directly, Salamu alayka, ayyuha al-Nabi. Rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Then, the moment we say Salamu alaykum, I finish my prayer, who am I to be at this, you know, hadra with Allah, the hadra of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, and I'm not doing the right things to be done? I cannot. Then I say, Astaghfirullah. The first thing after you finish your prayer, do Istighfar. Ya Allah, forgive me not being able to do the salah at the level that should be done. Okay? And that's why in our dhikr we say, Astaghfirullah. Toward the end, as Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, or the scholar, they say, if you start any dua with salawat of Rasulullah, the Durood Sharifa, and ended with Durood Sharifa, you know, Allah said, This Salah on Rasulullah is accepted 100%. And when we do Salah on Rasulullah, it's accepted 100%. And Allah, from His generosity, will not, you know, leave anything in between. He accepts the beginning and the end. All the dua in between is accepted. That's why they say, if you want to make dua, start doing Salah on Rasulullah and end with the Salah on Rasulullah. And in between, do whatever dua you want. So, inshallah, that will be all accepted as our scholar told us. Now, I want to talk about what's the best way of benefiting from Ramadan, from these last 10 nights, from Laylatul Qadr, from everything in our life. There's two things very important. The first one, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, نية المؤمن خير من عمله. نية المؤمن خير من عمله. What's the meaning of that? Your intention is better than your action. Your intention is better than your action. Give you an example how we can apply this. You intended, for example, somebody, let's say, who is sick, but his intention, and he cannot pray, for example, standing, he praying sitting, but his intention that if he is not sick, he will be praying standing. So his prayer sitting is better than praying standing. Because his intention is better than the action. The same way if like one of the sisters, she is pregnant or breastfeeding, and she is not fasting. But her intention is to fast, if she can. That means that status of not fasting is better than fasting. Because niyatul mu'min khairun min 'amali. That's one level. The second level is, my intention is, I want to memorize Quran. Or my intention is, I want to do Salah al-Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Durud Sharifa, all the time. But in reality, what happened, I did this intention. In reality, what happened, that I do some Salah al-Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then I get busy. And then I do Salat al-Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whatever, even 1 minute, 2 minutes, and so on. Because of the intention, the scholar, they say, Allah will fill the gaps for you. All the gaps are filled because of your intention. نِيَّةُ الْمُؤْمِنِ خَيْرٌ مِنْ عَمَلِ. That's another level of the intention. A third level of intention, which is amazing, if really you try to apply it on yourself, it opens a wide door for gaining of barakah, which is, as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من غاب عن شيء فرضي كان كمن حضر ومن حضر شيء فكره كان كمن غاب عنه أو كما قال المصطفى صلى الله عليه وسلم. What's the meaning? He says صلى الله عليه وسلم, if you are not present in an incident or a gathering and you are pleased with what they are doing, it's like you are there, get the same reward. And if you are present in a gathering or an incident and you hate that, it's like you are not there. So how can we apply this? Few days back, we read the Badriya here. We read about Ghazwat Badr and the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, that they spend their time with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they give their soul to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we are pleased with what they did. According to this intention, you are like you are there with them. And you get the reward, the same reward. It's been mentioned that a leader of army, he saw a huge army, you know, filling all the valley. And he said, I wish that I was at the time of Rasulullah to give him victory. He saw in his dream that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted your intention and gave you reward as you give victory to Rasulullah. So now what you can do, you can go through the seerah, and whenever you read something you like, you know, you are pleased with it. Or in your life, when something you don't like, you hate, that's in your heart. Now, what's the flip point of this, or flip coin of this, which is not good? If you hear something, let's say on TV or whatever it is, about something really bad happened, you know, they are having certain celebration or you enjoy that, it's like you are there. So you have to watch our heart. That counts. That's the main thing. Because Allah said in the Quran, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, يوم لا ينفع مال ولا بنون إلا من أتى الله بقلب سليم. A day that nothing will help you, nothing benefits you, except nothing benefits you, not your children, not your money. Mal benu will not help you on the judgment. That day, only if you bring and come with qalb salim, the heart that's pure, the heart that's nothing in it. They say your heart is like a ship, a boat on the water. And the water is the dunya. As long as the dunya is not inside your heart, your boat, your ship will go toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The moment you allow the love of the dunya inside your heart, what happened to that boat? Goes down. So we have to watch. That's why we have 5 prayers. We have a dhikr in between. And we ask Allah, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ. Just to, whenever this goes in the heart, we try to clean it. That's why the salawat on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, if you do 1 salah on me, Allah will do 10 on you. 10 on me. So let's say today we did 100 salawat on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. All of you did 100 salawat. Then Allah did on us 1,000 salah on all of us, one by one. And automatically when Allah is doing salawat on you, on me, the angel is doing with Allah. And Allah said in the Quran, عَدُ اللَّهِ الْبَارِجِينَ هُوَ الَّذِي يُصَلِّي عَلَيْكُمْ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ لِيُخْرِجَكُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ. Allah and the angel do salah on you to take you away from darkness to your light. I cannot take myself from darkness but myself in light. I cannot. You know, here in the West, even in our country nowadays with all this, you know, media and so on, there's darkness everywhere. In order for myself to take myself, I cannot. I do salawat on Rasulullah. I do Durood Sharifa. That's why back home in Damascus, almost every masjid they sit and they do Majlis Salah ala Nabi, they call it, a sitting on salawat on Rasulullah. They do 92,000 salah on Rasulullah as a group. So each one like 100 and so on, they gather till they reach that number. So the first thing which is we said is the intention. And that intention, the niyyah, niyyat al-mu'min, khayrun min amalih. So think about not one intention, do like 20 intentions. 30 intention. The scholar, they say when you enter the masjid, just put intention in yourself that I'm doing i'tikaf. I'm going to do dhikr of Allah. I'm going to do, you know, meeting people. And so I'm going to learn. I'm going to teach. I'm going to do all, any intention you can think about it, you can do it. Make your life like this. Make your heart always connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with thinking about your life. The moment you wake up, think about what Allah wants from me today. When you go and see things happen, okay, somebody came to me, need help. Allah brought it to me because Allah wanted me to gain something from it. So as we said, the first one is intention. The second thing is حسن الظن بالله, the good opinion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is more powerful than the intention. Having a good opinion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah said in hadith Qudsi, أنا عند حسن ظن عبدي في فليظن فيما يشاء إن خيرا فخير وإن شرا فشر. وكما قال سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, I'm at the opinion of my slave of me. If he thinks good of me, it will be good. If he thinks bad, it will be bad. So for us, if we think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive all our sins, Allah will do that. If you think that Allah will have mercy on you, He will have mercy on you. If somebody thinks that Allah will not forgive him, Allah will not forgive him. That's why Allah said in the Quran, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِي الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَى أَنفُسِهِمْ. Oh, tell the people who did all the sins, لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Don't have qunut. Don't think that Allah will let you down. Don't be half despair. Inna Allah yaghfiru dhunuba jami'an. Inna huwa al-ghafur rahim. Allah will forgive all the sins. They say every group of people, they have a verse from the Quran that give them the highest hope. The highest hope. For general Muslim, this is the verse that give the highest hope. Because they said, "Who you tell my people who really did all the sins, all the bad things, Allah will forgive you." This is for, you know, general people. Ahlul Bayt, they have another verse that they have higher hope than this. And the verse is, and it said, وَلَا سَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. Allah will give you, talking to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah will give you until you are pleased. And the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Ahlul Bayt, they have this as, this is the highest hope. We don't care. It's not our sin. It's our Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's our lineage to him. It's our relation to him. Is his love to us and our love to him. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, what did he say? He said, raise your children on three things. أَدِّي بَأُولَادِكُمْ عَلَى ثَلَاثٍ. حُبِّي, my love. وَحُبَّ أَهْلِي. The love of my family. And the Quran. He said, raise your children on three things. That's it. And what do we say in all our prayer? اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل. All the Muslims make ask Allah for barakah for the Ahlul Bayt. لذلك their hope, the high hope is what? ولا سوف يعطيك ربك فترضى. And there is other verses in the Quran for other groups. It's been mentioned in some of the books that every category they have different verse. Sayyidina Abu Bakr, he have one verse for him. For him, this is the highest hope. And it's amazing way of thinking that Sayyidina Abu Bakr had. What's the verse? قُلْ كُلٌّ يَعْمَلُ عَلَى شَاكِلَتِهِ. Say, everyone will act according to his, for human being, for, to his design, to his, you know, his capability, to the way he was made. So, what's the meaning of this? Why this is the highest hope for Sayyidina Abu Bakr? And he said, Ya Allah, shakilati al-dhamb. I'm designed for sins. وَشَاكِلَتُكَ الْمَغْفِرَةِ. And Ya Allah, you are for مَغْفِرَةِ. I'm going to do my job and you do your job. قُلْ كُلٌّ يَعْمَلُ عَلَى شَاكِلَتِهِ. Look, they see, يعني, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put things for us, just for us to go away from the hellfire, go to paradise. And he wanted to honor us. And this is called husnul dhan. In a hadith, it said that عجب ربكم لقنوط عبده وقرب غيره. Allah is amazed or have عجب when a slave have a qunut that he lost the hope. وقرب غيره, and the change for him is very close. Like for example, somebody in a big problem, okay, and or there is a war or something, and that night they lost hope. They lost hope completely. The change is happening in the morning. So Allah, he knew that here they lost hope, and after 1 hour is the answer. Allah is like, عَجِبَ رَبُّكُمْ لِقُنُوطِ عَبْدِهِ وَقُرْبِ غَيْرِهِ. And this is said, it's said in the Quran. حَتَّى إِذَا اسْتَيْأَسَ الرُّسُلُ وَظَنُّوا أَنَّهُمْ كُذِبُوا. وظنوا أنهم قد كذبوا جاءهم نصرنا. The messenger, they lost hope. And everybody around them thought it's all a lie. ظنوا أنهم كذبوا. At that moment when they lost hope, and the weak people, they saw that this is, doesn't make sense, you know, so then the victory came. So back to having good opinion. سيدنا أبو هريرة نريت حديث عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رضي الله عنه سيد قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن الله عز وجل قال أنا عند ظن عبدي بي إن ظن بي خيرا فله وإن ظن شرا فله. So this hadith in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, رضي الله عنه narrated this hadith that think your relation with Allah. If you think that Allah brought you on this earth and allow you to know La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah and allow you to pray 5 times and allow you to fast and allow you to all of this, Allah is doing all of this for you in order for what? To honor you. He wanted to honor all of us. He wanted to have mercy on all of us. Sayyidina Ali said that it's like that Allah wanted to have rahmah on all of this ummah. And the proof of this that Allah gave this ummah Ramadan. Because Allah gave us Ramadan, Allah wanted to have mercy on us. And also said that Allah loves this ummah. And the proof of this, that Allah made this ummah belong to his Habib, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because Allah loves Sayyidina Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, gave him this ummah. That's why Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said in the hadith, When he came to the Sahaba, he was smiling with beautiful face. He came on them and he said, أَنَا حَظُّكُمْ مِنَ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ وَأَنْتُمْ حَظِّي مِنَ الْأُمَمِ. I'm your luck amongst prophets and you are my luck amongst nations. In another way, Allah is saying that I'm the gift that Allah gave you amongst all prophets. Allah gifted this me to you. لقد من الله على المؤمنين. Allah gave him favor when he sent Rasulullah SAW to us. And he said, Allah gave me gift you. But whom do you think will take care, the best care of his gift? Us or Rasulullah SAW? Definitely Rasulullah. Allah described him. حريص عليكم عليه ما عنتم حريص عليكم بالمؤمن الرؤوف الرحيم. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم always say أمتي أمتي. He will not say أمي my mother. He will say أمتي. In any situation, رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم in and there is خير in it, he will ask for us. Even in a place where you lose your intellect, with the beauty and with the light. When the Isra and Mi'raj, he met Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he said, talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, said, تَحِيَّاتُ لِلَّهِ الصَّلَوَاتُ الطَّيِّبَةِ. And then Allah told him, السَّلَامُ عَلَيْكَ أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم remembered all of us. He said, سَلَامُ عَلَيْنَا وَعَلَى عِبَادِ اللَّهِ الصَّالِحِينَ. We are عباد الله. Remember the verse we said, the beginning, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِ الَّذِينَ أَسْفَرُوا مُسْلِمِ. Oh my slave, he told us عِبَادِ. He didn't say, oh you human being, oh you nas. He said, you my slave, that you did all the sins, I'll forgive you. So Rasulullah SAW said, سَلَامُ عَلَيْنَا وَعَلَى عِبَادِ اللَّهِ الصَّالِحِينَ. Why? He wanted to include us in everything there is خير in. And he told us. He told us there isn't anything there is in khair in it except I show it to you so you can give from it. And there is anything there is evil in it except I point it to you so you can avoid it. And now how he is getting to to take care of his gift that Allah gave him, told us, حياتي خير لكم ومماتي خير لكم. My life is good for you and my death is good for you. During my life, you do things, you need guidance, Allah will give me revelation, I'll give it to you. After I died, your action being presented to me, تعرض علي أعمالكم. Your action being presented to me. إذا وجدت خيرا حمدت الله. If I find something good, I do hamd on your behalf. And if I find something else, he didn't say evil, then I do istighfar on your behalf. Who is doing hamd? Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. Wallahi, if I did, let's say today I prayed to rak'at Allah by myself, you know, just for sake of getting close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I think something good, you know. If I want to do hamd of this two rak'ah that I did, or let's say I give charity, I want to thank Allah for this. If I thank Allah 1,000,000 years, 1,000,000 years, won't be equal to one hamd of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because he is Muhammad, Ahmad, Mahmud. He is the owner of Liwa al-Hamd. He is the owner of the Maqam al-Hamd. He is the one who knows how to do hamd. So he's doing hamd on my behalf. And it being narrated in another hadith that on the day of judgment, a person will come, you will come and look at action. It's like amazing, you know, barakah in it, huge. And you're going to ask Allah, whose prophet has this action? And the answer will say, no, it's your action. But what happened? Your action be presented to Rasulullah. He cleared it. He filtered it out. He put hamd in it and wrap it with hamd, give it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, present it. And another hadith is said that Allah will take your good action and will let it grow. Let it grow. So your action will be presented to Allah with the hamd of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with the khair from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then you cannot recognize your action. So this is the way Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is taking care of you, of his gift, which is أنتم حظي من الأمم. On the other, you know, if we did something wrong, a sin, something not good, then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will not come say, what's he doing? No, he'll do istighfar. He will do istighfar on our behalf. And Allah said in the Quran, وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ يَضْضَرَمُوا أَنفَسُهُمْ جَاءُوكَ. If they oppress themselves by doing something bad, they come to you, جَاءُوكَ, in the Quran. فَاسْتَغْفَرُوا اللَّهُ وَاسْتَغْفَرُهُمْ لَلْرَسُولِ. They do istighfar, ask Allah for forgiveness, Rasulullah will do istighfar for them. Allah said, فَاسْتَغْفَرُهُمْ لَلْرَسُولِ. And he told Rasulullah sallam, your act will be presented to me, I'm going to do either hamd or istighfar. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala planned everything in this dunya for our own benefit. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, ما يصيب المسلم من نصب ولا وصب ولا هم ولا حزن ولا أذى ولا غم حتى شوك يشاكها إلا كفر الله بها من خطايا. There is anything bad that come to Muslims, whether he is tired, whether he is or sadness or anything that's terrible on him, even a needle will hit him, except Allah will erase sin from his record. So and some scholars, they say that it's enough. I think it's a hadith, I'm not sure right now, but in the Athar said that the pain of death, when the soul leaves the body, that pain by itself, for the Muslim, it's enough to forgive all his sins. And Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said in the hadith, Sayyidina Jabir narrated that, I heard Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم 3 days before he died, صلى الله عليه وسلم. 3 days, he said, لا يموتن أحدكم إلا وهو يحسن ظن بالله عز وجل. He said, he knew that he's dying. He said, don't die except you have a good opinion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Have a good opinion. Not only that Allah will save you from the hellfire, but Allah will honor you, will get you without, you know, accounting, and He will get you in paradise, and will get you in the Firdaus al-Ahla. Have a good opinion. Even Allah told us in paradise there is فيها ما لا عين رأت ولا أذن سمعت ولا خطر على قلب البشر. In it, there is nothing even can come to your mind was in paradise. None of the eyes have seen it, or you heard about what's in paradise, or you cannot even think what's in it. So have a good opinion that, Ya Allah, I'm going to get all of this and more. This is sincerity. This is in the heart. When your heart is sincere with Allah, it's not the action, it's the heart. Because Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم told Sayyidina Mu'adh, Ya Mu'adh, أخلص العمل يكفيك منه القليل. Ya Mu'adh, أخلص العمل. He said Sayyidina Mu'adh. You know, there's a special relationship between Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم and Sayyidina Mu'adh. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم loved Sayyidina Mu'adh. And he told him once, Ya Mu'adh, والله إني لأحبك. Said, Ya Mu'adh, I swear by Allah that I love you. And then he told them, don't let any prayer pass except after we finish the prayer, say, Allahumma inni ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa hasni ibadah. So he told them, Wallahi inni la uhib. I love you, Mu'adh. Any prayer you pray, whether it's farad or sunnah, when you finish, salam alaykum, sir, Allahumma inni ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa hasni ibadah. Allah help me to mention you, ala dhikrika wa shukrika, to thank you and have a good ibadah for you. But he told them what? Have sincerity. أخلص العمل يكفيك منه القليل. Have sincerity in what you're doing. It's a little bit of action is enough for you. يكفي قليل. You don't have to do, you know, worshipping day and night all the time. Just, you know, when you, instead of praying 10 rak'ah, pray 2 rak'ah with really sincerity. يكفيك منه القليل. Now, once you know this, and you compare our ummah to previous ummah, and the relationship with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the relationship with Allah with different prophets, you'll find the big difference. I'll give you an example. Allah said, he used to tell the prophet, "Ud'uni astajib laka." Tell the Prophet, ask me, I'll give you whatever you want. This ummah didn't say, Ya Rasulullah, ask me, I'll give you. He said, Ud'uni astajib lakum. The whole ummah. Ud'uni, ask me, I'll give you. It's not only for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, what did he say? هذه الأمة أمة مرحومة. This ummah is a nation that have mercy. لا عذاب عليها في الآخرة. No punishment on this ummah in the آخرة. عذابها في الدنيا. Their punishment in this dunya with 3 things. بالقتل, by killing themselves, you know, left and right. We see it all over. والزلازل, earthquake. والفتن, problems. And we see it now. The moment the ummah go away from the deen, all of a sudden everything happened in this ummah. So هذه الأمة أم مرحومة. And Allah gave us Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم to take care of us in this dunya and in the grave, in the day of judgment, in the resurrection, in the day of judgment. All these stages, the Sahaba will take care of us. And he told us, شفاعتي لأهل كبائر من أمتي. My shafa'ah is for people of big sins of this ummah. He said, نعم العبد أنا لشرار أمتي. What a blessing I am for the evil of my ummah. And now he wanted us to not helping him, but I don't know how to say it. Make it easy on him or let him deal with the worst case scenario, what he wants. He taught us what to say in your dua. And he gave us two examples. The first one, he said, there was two men, young men, they lived the same life, born the same moment, died the same moment, and worship Allah, the same worship. After they died, Allah put the first one in the first level of paradise and the second one in Firdaus al-A'la, the highest position. So the one in the first level, he said, Ya Allah, this is not fair for me. Ya Allah, why? We lived the same life. We did the same thing. He said, yes. All your life you asked me to save you from hellfire, let you enter paradise. And I did. And all his life will ask me to save him from hellfire and let him be in the Firdaus al-A'la. And I did. So that's what he asked. He asked, Ya Allah, I want to be with Firdaus al-A'la. So that's the first one. The second one is more amazing. The second one is when the caravan of Sayyidina Musa, when they run away from Fir'aun and Pharaoh, the caravan is not moving, the camel is not moving. You know, Sayyidina Musa, he talks to Allah. You know, any issue with Sayyidina Musa, he'll go to Allah. Ya Allah, I have this, I have this. Allah gave him this open channel. And he knew the caravan, Bani Israel promised Sayyidina Yusuf that they will, if they leave Egypt, they will take his body with them. And he said, okay, where is his grave? Nobody knew. Okay? So, sorry, let me go back at the beginning of the story. I forgot one thing. There was, in the battlefield, Rasulullah ﷺ, and he went to overcome the enemy, and they need shortcut. A Bedouin came, gave them shortcut. And he said, come to Medina, I'll reward you. He came to Medina after a few days. He said, ask anything you want. He said, I need a ba'ir. I need a few camels full loaded with food and whatever it is. And he said to the Sahaba, give them. And he told them, after he left, what a big difference between the request of this Bedouin and the request of Bani Israel, Ajuz Bani Israel, the old lady of Bani Israel. They said, Rasulullah, what's the story of the old lady of Bani Israel? And he said the story that they need to know where is the grave. So Allah told him that the old lady of Bani Israel knew where is the place of the grave, said Yusuf. Sayyidina Musa, bring her. She came. Please rush. We're going to run away from Fir'aun. They're going to come and kill us. She said, I'll tell you what is the grave. I know. But I need one request. Said, ask anything you want. She said, I need murafaqataka fil jannah. I want to be with you in paradise. To be your companion in paradise. Sayyidina Musa, he only said truth. He said, yani, in himself, I'm from the five, Ulil Azm, from five prophets, the highest. And I talk to Allah and the prophet and the Nabi and messenger. How am I going to put her at the same level? And he said, no, I cannot. That's the only request. He talked to Allah, Ya Allah, that's what she wants. He said, are you giving her from you or me? This story narrated by Rasulullah. Are you giving from you or me? He said, no, from you, Ya Allah. He said, give her. And he gave her that. And they got the body of Sayyidina Yusuf and they were saved from Fir'aun. So, to teach us how to make dua and what to make. You know? Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. Allah told us in the Quran, كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس. We are the best nation. We have to know ourselves. Who are we? Now, if we come to what we call Laylatul Qadr, all of us when I have Laylatul Qadr, what is Laylatul Qadr? What is it? It's a request, it's an answer of one request for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah asked Allah, Ya Allah, previous nation, they lived 1,000 years. My ummah is 60 to 70 years old. maybe up to 100 years. And Allah gave him one night. Laylatul Qadr khayr min alf shahr, better than 83 years, 84 years. So Laylatul Qadr is one request of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, if we come to reality to understand Laylatul Qadr, Allah said in the Quran, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ. They didn't know the qadr of Allah. Qadr is ta'zeem, is the highest level of ta'zeem, is qadr. The highest level. So Allah told us, He didn't know the highest level of Allah. مَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ. So Laylatul Qadr is a way to come close to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to know the qadr of Allah. The same way to know Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the qadr of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As we say in the poem, لَكَ قَدْرٌ عَظِيمٌ لَيْسَ يُضَاهُ. Your qadr is عَظِيم. Nobody can reach that qadr. The scholar they say, or the arifin they say, مَا عَرَفَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ سَلَمْ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Nobody knew Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam except Allah. We don't know, it's He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We don't know what Allah chose and said, this is my Habib. Not only He said, this is my Habib, He said, I love him and I give you permission to love him also. You know, for us human beings, if we love something, we want to have it to ourselves only. Only I want to love, that's mine. Allah said, you are allowed to love. Not only this, He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will be rewarded on how much you love him. The more you love him, the higher position. Love of Rasulullah can put you in a position that none of your action, if you live 1,000 years, you cannot reach that position. Because why? Because al-mar'u ma'a man ahab. You'll be with the one you love. The love will put you at that level. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad. Okay, so Laylatul Qadr is to know the Qadr of Allah, to know the Qadr of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to know the Qadr of the Qur'an. A Qur'an, a rope, from one side is in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the other side in your hand. This is amazing. Whether we understand the meaning or not, some scholars, they say, not understanding the meaning, it's higher than understanding the meaning. And I don't know why, what's the meaning of that, but it's written in the books. You get reward whether we know how to read it or not. But try to read it. There is a lot of things shows that this ummah is completely different than other nations. There will be a time when all the nations, you know, Rasulullah will give the shafa'a, shafa'a al-uzma, that people, you know the story that goes from all prophets until Rasulullah, we need your help from that day of 50,000 years of pain under the sun. We need your help, all the prophets say, nafsi, nafsi, I can't do anything. And then Rasulullah will ask Allah, will do sajda, in the sujood he will do hamd, never heard before. And then that sujood will bring the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he say, okay, go to the courtyard. What's happening in the courtyard? Allah is the judge. Allah is just, adil. And Allah will show everybody, you know, in the court, every case by itself. It starts with the pen. Allah will say, bring the pen. أحضر القلم. The pen will come shaking that day. You know, they say the pen is an angel. And the lawah is an angel. Allahu A'lam. So, Allah will say, where is all the books I gave you? You pen, ayyuh al-qalam. Said, ya Allah, I gave it to the tablet. Bring the tablet. The tablet will come shaking. The pen claims, Allah tell him, the pen claims that gave you all the books. The tablet will say, yes, ya Allah. So the pen now is free. That's his, you know, court. And then what did you do with it? I give it to Jibreel. Bring Jibreel. Sidna Jibreel will come. The tablet claims that they gave you the Quran and the Torah and the Injil and Zabur and this book and the book. Yes, Allah is saying truth. Okay, tablet is free now. What did you do with it to Sidna Jibreel? He said, I gave it to prophets. Okay, to Noah, to Ibrahim. Bring Noah. Sayyidina Nuh will come. Jibreel claims that gave you the instruction, whatever form it is, the instruction. Yes, I give it to my nation. Okay. This is the nation of Nuh, Sayyidina Nuh. Nuh claims that gave you the instruction. All of them, they say, Ya Allah, he's a liar. He didn't give us anything. Oh, Nuh. They said, you are lying. Said, I have witness. Who are your witness? There is a platform high, sitting, and us, this ummah, there. Allah said in the Quran, لِتَكُونُ شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ وَيَكُونُ الرَّسُولُ عَلَيْكُمْ شَهِدًا. You're going to be witness over all human beings. And Rasulullah will be witness over you. After all the nation being accounted and either gone to paradise or hellfire, and nobody else there, our account will happen, and our Rasulullah is the witness over us. Rasulullah will not allow anybody to go to hellfire. So, Allah will tell them, do you witness? He said, yes. What do you say? And then he starts reciting the verse, لَقَدْ أَرْسَلَنَا نُوحًا إِلَى قَبْلِهِ. He said, Nuh to his people, and they did this, and this, and this, and this. They did, they called them in a secret, and in public, and then and so on, and they got up their head. They put their finger in their ear and so on. Then Allah will say, okay. They take all that nation by itself. Boom, the hellfire. Khalas. When it comes, for example, to Sayyidina Musa, what did you do with the Torah? I gave it to the Jews. They say, yes, he gave it to us. The moment this happened, this, yes, we got the Torah opened, one by one. Okay, the Torah said, do this. Did you do it? Don't hunt on Saturday. Do this, do that, and so on. Go line by line for every person. And then goes to us now. So, all the nations, they wish to have a special relationship to this ummah, to us. They wish that. Why? Because we are the witness of the court. What an honor. Wallah, you have to recognize the qadr. Our qadr, not because us, we are not guilty. But our qadr that we are lucky that we belong to Sayyid Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The only problem, and that is big problem nowadays. If one of our children or us will leave the deen, that means he lost this, the whole qadr. The whole mercy, everything he lost. And we know people. I have relatives that their children, they left the deen. It's ajeeb. So this is Laylatul Qadr, is to know the Qadr of Allah, Qadr of Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Qadr of the Quran, Qadr of this deen, and Qadr of all of us, this ummah. This ummah. That's why Sayyidina Hudhayfa رضي الله عنه said that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم قال said that فضلنا على الناس بثلاث. We have something overcome other nations with three things. جعل صفوفنا كصفوف الملائكة. Our rows made as the rows of angels. And the way we pray is the same way the angels will have rows. وجعلت لنا الأرض مسجدا وتربتها طهورا. Allah made this earth a masjid. And the soil is a way of purification. This is the second one. Now, do you know what's this earth? When you pray by yourself, what's your intention? You know what intention? I'm praying in the masjid of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Because he said, جُعِلَتْ لِيَ الْأَرْضُ مَسْجِدًا. Allah made the whole earth is my masjid. So when you pray by yourself, or you and your wife, or jama'ah in your house, not in the masjid, whatever it is, Make intention and bring the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What an honor. And the third thing, وَأَعْطِيتُ آخِرَ سُورَةِ الْبَقَرَةِ فَهُنَّ مِنْ كَنْزٍ تَحْتَ الْعَرْشِ. And I given was the last few verses of the Surah Al-Baqarah. It was a treasure under the throne. Under the throne given to this ummah. Then inshallah we'll open the door. There's a lot of other things to be said, but let's go with Q&A if somebody has Q&A. Bismillah. Anybody have a mic or no? How are we going to do it? Muhammad, you have a mic for Q&A or whatever? I can hear. Anybody have any question, anything you want to talk about or discuss before we do tasbih, salat tasbih?
يا حبيبي يا رسول الله
anybody yes السلام question how رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم spent ليلة القدر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم in Ramadan in general okay His generosity will be multiplied 100 times. And his generosity will multiply more when Sayyidina Jibreel will come to him and recite the whole Quran. So the whole Quran will be recited with Sayyidina Jibreel in Ramadan. Okay? The last 10 days, he will do i'tikaf. Okay? He will be in the masjid, will not leave. But 1 year, I think there was a battle, I forgot which one, he couldn't do i'tikaf. The year after, he did 20 days i'tikaf to make up for the year before. Okay? Now, in his i'tikaf, now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he knew when is Laylatul Qadr. Okay? And he came, one day he came to Sahaba and came to tell them when is Laylatul Qadr. To tell them exactly when is Laylatul Qadr. When he came to tell them that, two of the Sahaba had some issue and they argue and they like almost a small fight. When that happened, that knowledge went away. Rasulullah was not allowed to be tell them when is Laylatul Qadr. But he told Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, Ya Rasulullah, if I find Laylatul Qadr, what should I say? He said, just say one thing. Allahumma innaka afuun kareem tuhibbu al-afwa fa'afu anna. Now, he will be doing, يعني, his ibadah is nobody like him. يعني, he will stand in prayer if he is by himself, night prayer. He will read, one incident, he read 5.5 juz of Quran in one, you know, the first rak'ah. And then when he do ruku', he will spend time in ruku' close to what he did in standing. And believe me, he cannot do it. I tried once to like do ruku' for a long time. I couldn't do it more than a few minutes. I couldn't. I wanted to do it long, that's what I did. Couldn't. And then he's standing after that, he spent time long, and his sujood, he spent time, long time. So almost one rak'ah the whole night. Almost. Okay. So that's completely, Rasulullah is different than us. Okay. And يعني, the channel between him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is open. But he wanted us to, as he told Sayyidina Mu'adh, يعني, have a sincerity in your action. Enough, little bit of action is enough for you. The practice of my shiuch with Laylatul Qadr, they sit and they celebrate Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because he's our Qadr. They don't care about these 8 years. They enjoy celebrating Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they have the seerah, and then they do salat al-sabih, they read some Quran, and that's it. But as long as all your night, you are not talking about dunya. Now I didn't hear anybody talking about dunya. You know? That's it. Now, any other question? Comments? Ya Habibi, Ya Rasulullah. Any question, maybe not related to the Qadr, that's fine. Okay, so we'll do Salat Asr, inshallah. Yeah, go ahead. So the question, what's the advice to give to raising children, whether it is here or in Damascus? From my experience, and I raised my children here, half of time here, half of time in Damascus. In both cases, I never had a TV in my home, and never put my kids in school, homeschooling all their life. The first test they have is entering the college. Alhamdulillah, they graduated from Berkeley. And that's in general the environment. For me, the thing I used to do before marriage, I stopped doing. You know, everything I want, like I used to watch TV myself. When I look at my children, Allah will ask me about them. كلكم راعٍ وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته. I stopped that. I used to do this, I stopped that. I used to do this, stop that. Just be a good mother for them. And take them your friend. Take them your friend. This way, Allahu A'lam, Alhamdulillah, that's the way I raise my children. This is the way, you cannot let somebody else, you know, raise your child in school or somewhere else. Allahu A'lam.